supposedly, as I understand, about a witch.
We're doing a documentary about the Blair Witch.
These odd stick figures that were like woven out of branches and trees.
A brutal murder in the Black Hills discovered today.
I'm so sorry.
I'm gonna die out of here.
What happened in Burkittsville when the movie came out was, well, he was suddenly overrun. I mean, it felt like some mass hysteria. It wasn't appreciated.
The crimes that were committed last year in Burkittsville, I mean, came as a big surprise to the whole community. It seems to be some kind of a connection to this legend, at least in people's minds.
Witches have haunted the passages of folklore throughout history. Oriental sorceresses, European hags, and voodoo priestesses are all variations on the same theme. Women in league with supernatural evil. They are blamed for the stillborn, bad crops, sudden illness, and anything else frightening men cannot explain away. America has a long tradition of persecuting witches. The famous trial in Salem was just one example of a mania that swept through the colony. Women accused of witchcraft were drowned, hanged, and burned at the stake. These bloody spectacles were widespread until late in the 18th century, when another bloody spectacle took their place, the American Revolution. After the War for Independence, history books tell us little about witchcraft in the United States. Local and regional folktales, however, are full of references to supernatural occurrences, and they're all too earthly consequences. One of the most dramatic examples of this is the Blair Witch of Western Maryland, which originated with an extremely rare book. 5. It is entitled The Blair Witch Cult. Commonly considered fiction, this strange tome documents the fate of an unknown Maryland township cursed by an outcast hag. Several children accused Ellie Kedward of luring them into her home to draw blood from them. In court, the children's wounds would prove damning evidence, and Kedward was found guilty of witchcraft and banished from the village in the middle of a particularly harsh winter. She was assumed to have died from exposure. Although the name of the town is not mentioned in the book, it is assumed from the title that it is set in Blair County, and the region's bizarre history certainly supports this assumption.
I'm the executive director to the Historical Society here in Burkittsville. I've been that quite a few years and known as a town historian. And I've tried to keep up with our history and make it be alive to the people that come behind me. Burkittsville was actually founded on another old South town by the name of Blair. And it was founded here in 1734 to protect the western approaches to Baltimore from attack by the Indians and so forth. But it died out because of a witch. Her name was Ellie Kedwards, and she took a bunch of the children and kidnapped them and carried them off into the woods, and they never found them again. And the people became very afraid, and they pulled up and left and abandoned the town. And it stayed abandoned for 40 years.
Though records from this period of history are scarce, this registry of the seafaring vessel, the Reliant, shows that a woman named Ellie Kedward, the woman history has labeled as the Blair Witch, did in fact sail from Ireland to Baltimore in the summer of 1769.
The Blair Witch story begins, like all other witch stories and legends, with an old haggard lady. And in this particular case, she was a Catholic living in a predominantly Protestant community.
The story goes that she had bled a few children, and by that pinpricks, probably because of some sort of illness that she detected or something to that effect. The children went back, reported it to their parents. This is, of course, at that time, an early sign of witchcraft. She was tried, summarily convicted, and banished. The winter she was banished was supposedly the worst ever, and no one knows what happened to her. She was left by herself out in the woods.
What they did was they blindfolded her, took her out into the woods, and this was in the middle of the winter, tied her to a tree, and left her. She soon succumbed to the elements.
The following year, the young lady who was her first accuser and most of the other children who were her accusers and children of the village vanished throughout the course of the winter. By the end of the winter, over half the town's children had disappeared.
Well, immediately, the townspeople blamed these disappearances on Ellie the witch. The people simply vacated the area. They left. They abandoned the community, and they never spoke about the incident again.
As he related to me, he had lived in a small town 40 miles to the north. The place had been abandoned, he told me, as it had come under a curse. The well-built homes that still stood there were boarded up and empty, with no sign as to why their denizens had chosen to leave so abruptly. This man had heard that the town had been cursed by a witch, and he claimed he had seen a cemetery full with the gravestones of children. But whether that is true or not, I could not say.
In 1809, a rare book about the occurrences surrounding the Blair Witch legend was discovered, entitled The Blair Witch Cult. This tome is supposedly a collection of first-hand accounts that illustrate the effects of the infamous Blair Witch.
And the book is filled with bloodletting, all kinds of bloody gore, witchcraft, paganism. Basically, it's a pack of lies. Don't believe any of it. But the people of the time did believe in it.
The awful hag wrenched the boy's head from his writhing body and defiled the church with his warm blood. It was then that I noticed a dog's teeth had sprouted from her leg. She controlled the animals of the forest, even the trees seeming to do her bidding. When she walked, she didn't touch the ground. And her followers made a horrible mulch of the countless dead littering the streets.
The Blair Witch Cult, 1609.
There were no more occurrences of the Blair Witch until about approximately 1825, 26. There was a drowning which took place of a young girl, anywhere between 8 and 10. It's another one where there's a lot of disparity.
The town was having their annual picnic out on Tappy Creek.
The creek was anywhere from 8 inches to 2 feet deep. Either way, it's not extremely deep.
And she was sitting down in the water and splashing around like a small child would do. But all of a sudden, she just started throwing water everywhere.
Supposedly, 11 witnesses saw a specter or a ghostly hand come up from the creek and drag this little girl underneath.
And the time they got there, she was gone.
I have to say, I don't quite understand. If there were 11 people close enough to be able to see that happen, how come one of them couldn't save her?
Her body was never found, and we just all knew that the Blair Witch had made another successful pillage of one of our children.
The river according to what we've been told through written records, then turns oily and has a bunch of stick figures floating into it for the next week. No one can use the river for any kind of water for food or drinking or anything like that. It's totally unusable.
After that, the people wouldn't even go near the creek. They wouldn't fish in it. They didn't swim in it. They didn't do anything in it because it just scared them completely to death. And they blamed that on the Blair Witch. There was a lady lived there in town when I was a boy. She was 50 years old when I knew her. And she told me that when she was a little girl, she would had been walking in the woods one day, and this lady appeared to her. And she wasn't walking. She was floating in the air, really. And took her by the hand and led her to an old house back in the woods and took her down in the basement and left her there and said she'd be back. And she left. And the little girl sat there, she said, for several hours, and finally she got scared. She ran, able to crawl through a window and ran back to town. But in the meantime, the town had started to search for her. They sent out a search party to look for her in the woods.
But it's plausible here that this little girl was only telling a story of the Blair Witch as she heard it from maybe her parents, her siblings, or her friends. But what is strange about this case was that the first search party that had gone out to look for the little girl had vanished.
When the entire search party failed to return, another search party was dispatched to find them. What they found was a massacre.
And that search party come up on Coffin Hill or Coffin Rock and found those men.
The first search party had been killed, laid out on a flat rock in the woods. They had been disemboweled, and on their faces, their hands and feet were carved these strange pagan symbols.
And they were heavily cut in by the rope, so they were alive when they were tied up. And somebody had disemboweled every one of them and cut some letters and stuff in their foreheads. And very good, it wasn't crude. You could read whatever was there. It was all symbolic type stuff. And it scared them very bad, and like most it would anybody. Like I couldn't have stood there very long.
Their bodies were in a severe state of decomposition. So the search party goes back to get help, and when they return, the bodies have vanished without a trace.
But they could still smell death in the air, which where men die or women die, that you can always smell that. And there was no sign of them there.
Now, if you notice, there's been an interval of about 60 years in between these events. And if we move forward to 1940, which is about 60 years, we find another interesting situation that happens in this very same area.
There are an unusually high number of children laid to rest here, most of whom passed in the 1940s. Yet no one in the town seems to recall anything unusual about this time, to us anyway. Yet legend tells a different story, one whose evidence is all around us, etched in stone.
Mr. Carr, were you alone in the killings? so far, how did you get the children into the woods?
Promised and things.
What kind of things?
Candy.
Did you kill other children that we don't know about, Mr. Parr?
No. Over here, Mr. Parr. Mr. Parr,
was at
the Blair Witch. Parr,
one more
picture,
please. Rustin's mother and father, they died around the 30s. And at that time already, Rustin was already living out in the backwoods.
He was very uncomfortable in society, and society was very uncomfortable with him. When he was arrested for killing seven children in Burkittsville, and I was serving that prison, I heard his confession, which I have kept as a private vow for, 50 years now.
Just like all the other sort of these tales to scare children, that kind of thing, Rustin had this reputation, just like the sort of the old scary house in the neighborhood where people say, oh, you know, whoever lives there, if you go near the house, they'll put a curse on you or something like that.
Finally finished, and that was his acceptance of death, I think. It had nothing to do with the crime. Everybody said, ah, but I don't think it had anything to do with the crime.
So they got the sheriff, come down, and he arrested him. And he went up to the cabin, and sure enough, he found seven bodies, not eight, but seven. And the eighth one that he didn't find was Kyle Brody.
While they were looking for the bodies in the home and uncovering those bodies, Kyle Brody comes walking back into the town of Burkittsville, and starts telling people about Rustin Parr and what Rustin Parr has been doing for the last year, how Rustin Parr held him captive there in his home, how Rustin Parr was committing these horrible, unspeakable acts to these children.
But he came back in town. He testified against him at the trial.
At least there's newsreel from the time. There are many written reports. So this thing went, you know, nationwide at that point. This was a big deal. I have to, got to give the guy some credit that he never really said that the Blair Witch told him to do it. He was asked that.
And ladies and gentlemen, I once again quote Kyle Brody. He told me to stand in the corner and face the wall. I could hear Emily screaming. He was cutting her. I looked. He was cutting a symbol on her face. Sometimes he would come up to me. Do you hear her? Do you hear the woman's voice? I would cry. After a few days, he killed her. He cut her open, and after he took everything out of her, he left with her, and I never saw her again. When he came back, he told me not to be sad, that he'd bring someone else back soon.
They burned Rustin Parr's house to the ground that night. He was hanged 4 months later, on November 22nd, 1941.
That's right, Frank. The turnout here has been really overwhelming as dozens of volunteers from all over the area have come here to help find these students. We have here with us now Deputy Hart, who's been leading today's operations. Deputy Hart, what do you think of this turnout?
Well, it's been a long day, but we've got great turnout from the Tri-County area. We've got school children and church volunteers, and so we've covered quite a bit of ground with them.
This is Burkittsville, formerly Blair. It is a small, quiet Maryland town, much like a small, quiet town anywhere. No more than 20 families laid their roots here over 200 years ago, many of whom remain either on this hill or in the town below. There are an unusually high number of children laid to rest here, most of whom passed in the 1940s. Yet no one in the town seems to recall anything unusual about this time, to us anyway. Yet legend tells a different story, one whose evidence is all around us, a etched in stone.
Yeah, Mr. Leonard, Keith Whitaker from News Channel 6. Can we have a moment of your time?
Yeah, what do you want?
Well, sir, footage has been found relating to the disappearance of your son, Joshua. Do you care to comment?
No, the cops haven't brought anything to us, and no, we don't have any comment.
Mr. Leonard, do you think the occult is involved in the disappearance of your son?
No, wait a second. No, I don't. And quite frankly, my wife and I are sick and tired of all this crap that's flying around this town about that, all right? Now leave us alone.
Well, how has this affected you and your wife, sir?
How do you think it makes us feel, Tom? I can't.
I hope you're never in my situation, and you never have to depend on Sheriff Cravens to help you out. Sheriff Cravens and his crew have been apathetic at best. They've just wanted to pretend like this whole thing would go away. They've even insinuated that these tapes and videos that are my daughter and her friends are a hoax, that they made this stuff up. They've been impossible.
So he's restricted access?
He's totally restricted access. There were over 20 hours of tapes found, and we've been allowed to watch about 4.5. And I feel like that was very edited. It was very select what we got to see. But what we did see were some strange occurrences that, I'm sorry, my daughter did not manufacture that stuff, but somebody did. Strange things, piles of rocks. They were in the tent and footsteps all around them. I mean, there's some sort of intervention. And these odd stick figures that were like woven out of branches and trees. And I don't know what it was. But I feel like if I could see the rest of the tape, maybe there'd be some clue.
So we're working over there, and all of a sudden I hear kind of a commotion from the other side of the foundation, and I hear like rocks banging together. And we kind of ran around the side, and apparently what happened was that Pete was removing a stone, and a section of the wall was caved in. Nobody was hurt. This section of the wall by this time was only about 4 or 5 feet off the ground. And so I got checked, and you know, nobody was injured. And I just told him, I said, you know, clear this out a little bit. And about 20 minutes later, Pete comes running up, and he's got this dirty old a backpack in his hand.
By the way they had located those, it appeared that the stones had been there for many, many years and had not been disturbed. So it makes you wonder how someone had removed those stones forensically, in other words, stone by stone, carefully not disturbing them, and then putting them back in the same exact order that they were originally in the ground. Makes you wonder why they were hiding them there. Certainly not for someone to find them, because they would probably stay there for years and years more if they hadn't have done that anthropology dig.
What I recognized real quickly were a couple 16-millimeter film cans, and there was also what looked like some videotape cartridges in there. This had nothing at all to do with colonial period stuff, of course, and so I called the sheriff.
Footage was found allegedly that was filmed by the three students. Contacted a local color lab. We got it developed, and I reviewed the film. And all I found was the students themselves, some scary noises in the woods at night, and a few examples of that, but no concrete evidence on what happened to the students.
Listen. Hello? Hello? It's all around us.
This backpack was found in a sterile soil, which is like the bottom of a site. It's just, you know, from there to the middle of the earth is just dirt. The original house at the site had burned down, and so there was a layer of ash that was like sitting in the interior of the house, like the basement. So this knapsack had been in sterile soil with no evidence around it of disturbance. Along over the top of it was an undisturbed layer of ash, and the whole thing was boxed in by basically a colonial era wall that was undisturbed. Even a forensic expert could not have put that thing into the site without disturbing the charcoal, the wall, or the sterile soil. It was as if it materialized. And of course, that's not the language of science, so I just don't know what to say about this, really.
At the time that the footage was found, it was scary. It was very, very eerie. It's not something that I really want to look at. To tell you the truth, I've kind of avoided it. I don't feel too comfortable with seeing the last few days of my brother's life on video. I really just don't feel too comfortable with that. It's very eerie.
Well, when they found this videotape or film or recordings of whatever it was, immediately the Blair Witch business emerged. People became superstitious, and they said, well, maybe this is connected to the Blair Witch. Well, I thought it was kind of fishy myself. I looked at the whole thing as possibly a hoax or whatever, but it was still strange.
After reviewing the film, I still thought it was a hoax.
Well, there's always that possibility, but I think, like I mentioned earlier, I think it would be remote that it's a hoax because of the way the tapes were hidden and the fact that it, just to view the tapes, they are very realistic, and the tape is from a time period that the students would have been able to have taped it.
On those reels that would be suspicious?
I really don't know. Things that I remember seeing the kids going into a house. That was part of it.
So you thought the house was kind of strange?
The house was strange, yeah, I think so, yes.
Now, was there a house found during the search or anything?
I believe not. On the clip, there was a house.
But nothing during the search?
During the search, I do not think we found anything of that. No.
That's pretty strange. Have you ever been up in those woods yourself?
No. Things are very scary in there. A lot of things happen in there. No, I've never been in the woods. I don't like the woods.
I first heard about this Blair Witch Project from one of the faculty of members of at MC, where I used to go to school. We keep in touch, and he contacted me and told me about this this unbelievable story.
I got involved with this project a while ago when Ed approached me with this story that he ran across, and when we started getting more and more involved with it and dredging up some of the facts behind it, it just completely blew me away.
It was the impact, the emotional response to their first telling me the story that would not let the story leave my mind.
These people were, students at the same place that I was. I mean, these people could have been, you know, me and my friends. So there's a real, you know, connection there.
Knowing that those film students may have been there and may have been fighting for their lives there in some form is enough to, I think, to want anyone to see what may be on those rolls of film.
So in 2 months, in October, when we are finally granted access to the materials, we are as unsure now as anybody as to what is on those videotapes, what is on those film rolls, what is on those sound reels.
And that's kind of the risk that we're running here. There may be nothing of any worth on the film.
And it's my fear that this doesn't turn into an Al Capone's vault.
I'm just real cautious about how we do this film because it's, you know, the footage could be nothing, but yet the footage could be quite spectacular, and we still have to keep in mind that three people are gone.
At Boyd's Country Store is the last place where the filmmakers are seen. And all we have left are those reels of film. And that's where we want to find our truth in this story.
I hope that the raw materials to put together a final story is there, that provides answers for us and for the families and for the public. That's what I hope is there.
The search of the three missing Montgomery College students continues in Frederick County tonight.
10 days and thousands of man hours have been unable to produce any clues.
We have a few leads, a few other options we want to take advantage of and just try to put together some pieces to this puzzle.
Do you believe the occult may be involved in the disappearance of your son?
Incidents that we've had happen is these three college kids went out into the woods in the Burkittsville area. They were going to make themselves a documentary concerning the Blair Witch, and they went missing, and they were assumed dead, and then sometime later, their equipment was found. They pieced together the material found. There were a lot of videotapes, some film reels and stuff, and they managed to piece this together in what they think implies that the Blair Witch attacked them and killed them. This is just really, this is absolutely more of the urban legend being built up. These kids aren't missing. They aren't dead. This is just a sick joke. That's the kind of stuff that sad, sick people perform on these kind of events.
Parts of it where they're actually talking to people in the town, I thought that was very interesting. It's people I haven't really met, and you know, then you're getting the actual stories about a person that actually lives there in the town saying, hey, yeah, I remember the Blair Witch. You know, they didn't seem to all believe in it, maybe a few did, so that was kind of interesting. You know, once we got into the whole woods and running away and screaming, and I don't know, I think that they've all got the last laugh is what I think.
Somebody makes a lot of money on something or something exciting happens, everybody wants to get in on it. And now there's a bunch of books being written and another sequel coming out.
Hi, I'm Kurt Loder with MTV News. The film is The Blair Witch Project.
Critics have called it one of the scariest films of all time.
I
was terrified.
Oh, it scared me to death.
It all starts out lighthearted as three documentary filmmakers armed with a 16-millimeter camera and a video camcorder head into the Black Hills Forest of Maryland to make a movie about a legendary witch.
And they're never heard from again.
Now, Blair Witch fans are not only flocking to the multiplex, they are flooding the little town of Burkittsville, Maryland.
There's no doubt about the box office success of the Blair Witch Project. What's not clear, though, is whether the Blair Witch legend is true.
Doba Henry at the Rockville Courthouse. That's where murder suspect Jeffrey Patterson's preliminary hearing is underway for his alleged role in a multiple homicide this past September. Dilva.
Well, it is starting to get cold out here, but we are not allowed inside the courthouse. The judge has ruled on a motion, which does not allow us to go inside. But I am standing here with Kathy Sherrar Patterson, mother of Jeff Patterson. Now, Jeff, along with two others whose names have not yet been released, are on trial for multiple homicides. This all happened in the Black Hills area in early September of last year.
Say the bodies of five other victims may have some connection to those found.
As authorities are still looking for the killer or
pronounced history of psychological
local Jeff
supposedly abducted four young adults.
A brutal murder in the Black Hills discovered today.
The names will be released until such a time as investigators feel it is in the best interest of the
investigators. Suspicions have been raised that Patterson did not
Burkittsville local Jeff Patterson may have committed or participated in
abductees assisted him in committing the violent crime.
Information that might lead authorities to justice, please call them on Montgomery County Sheriff's Office at the number at the bottom of your screen.
It's been a week since multiple homicide victims were discovered in Seneca State Park and the Black Hills Forest. Burkittsville native Jeff Patterson has been detained by authorities who believe he is somehow connected to these crimes. Donald McFarrell, Patterson's defense attorney, believes his client is being accused on circumstantial evidence.
We're talking about someone who has been made a suspect because he looked suspicious, and this makes me very, very irate. When this is over, I will file a suit against the city of Burkittsville and Montgomery County, Maryland, because it's wrongful arrest.
I'm convinced we got the bad guy. To me, Jeff Patterson did it. He's the guy I'm after. He's the bad guy in the story.
The case against Jeffrey is going to have to be based on the information that we have gathered from the crime scene.
When he was nine, his father, who was a local artist in Burkittsville, and Jeffrey went for a camping trip. On that trip, Jeffrey's father sustained severe head trauma, injury to his spinal cord, and that resulted in him being completely incapacitated for the rest of his life.
We found out later there's some suspicions on that. It was just kind of passed over because no one thought this kid was 9 years old.
Now, some people are inferring that Jeffrey was responsible for that accident. I will not come to that conclusion. What I would say is that one way or the other, a nine-year-old witnessing this event can't not be traumatized and affected by it. In his early teens, Jeffrey kidnapped a baby of a neighbor.
He kidnapped a kid, a baby. That is not normal.
If indeed Jeffrey is the offender of these crimes, we can definitely go back and say this kidnapping, it was very carefully executed and specifically executed, and he stalked that baby and planned that crime.
You've probably heard about the Walker case. Very close friends of ours, and the family was at our house often, and they called it a kidnapping. It was not a kidnapping. It was an act of compassion on my son's part. Rather than go to jail, he went to an institution.
Jeff Patterson came to us when he was on the verge of 18 years old, a couple of months shy of his 18th birthday, and Jeff was brought here because he had abducted, there's no easier way to say it, an infant. And it took this infant into the woods. According to Jeff, it was in response to voices that he was hearing, not uncommon among schizophrenics, and I'm afraid that had to be the diagnosis. I met a very bright, a very energetic, and when I say energy, I'm not just talking about physical energy, I'm talking about psychic energy, I'm talking about the energy of soul that he brought to the world.
So he's apparently been on medication for it. There's no cure for it, but if a schizophrenic stays on medication, the symptoms are repressed. And I would be very interested to find out if prior to this recent event, Jeffrey stopped taking the pills.
He demanded three forms of therapy, one pharmaceuticals, the other electroshock treatments, and the third, and most important, very intensive therapy, talk, exchange. And he left here a man capable of assimilating into the larger society.
I can say a lot about Jeff's imagination. It's awesome, it's prodigious, it's vivid.
He planned to someday, or hoped, dreamed. And he certainly had the mental capacity and the creative imagination to do it, to make his own films. Certainly the Blair Witch was one of those that affected him most deeply.
This is crazy.
Book of Shadows was, I believe, the title of the movie that he planned to make.
To look at his room, it looks like a shrine to the Blair Witch. And what was really interesting, in some cases, he had taken pictures of himself and pasted them, one of them, on one of the posters. So that, I mean, he wanted so much to be a part of this Blair Witch thing that he actually put himself in the pictures. Agent Tenshu can tell you that's, as far as profiling goes, man, this guy's a classic case.
Jeff is very charismatic, very charming. You know that I look at? The guy knew what he was doing. He had a plan from the start. So he took 3 or 4 days in the woods to figure out, you know, who the victims were going to be and who his accomplices were going to be. And I guess I was an accomplice. I don't know, maybe he thought he was the Blair Witch. I couldn't imagine what goes through Jeff's
I don't know that much about the other two that have been accused in the Jeff Patterson case because I haven't been given much information on them.
The two people who are accused of conspiring with Jeff Patterson don't even have a long relationship with him.
One of them, as I may have mentioned, had minor run-ins with the law as a teenager. The usual thing. There was an assault case, but that was high school. Stupid kid stuff. The other kid, clean record. Most definitely Jeff Patterson is the killer. He acted alone. Yes, he had these other two individuals as hanger-ons, but as far as the murders go, I'm convinced he acted alone.
I think people that come together and become obsessed and frightened usually don't lead to a good end.
After the crowds left, 5 strangers returned to the woods to uncover the truth. But one of them has a secret that will unlock the curse.
You know, if you don't believe in the Blair Witch, then why the hell did you bother to come?
I thought the movie was cool.
This fall, just in time for Halloween, the Witch is back. On October 27th, forget everything you've heard. Forget everything you've seen. Because this time, the truth is scarier than fiction.
A brutal murder in the Black Hills discovered today.
In the past year, the Black Hills area has been overrun with movie fans wanting to get a glimpse of where the Blair Witch Project was filmed.
From filmmaker Lisa Arlington comes a new documentary, The Absence of Closure. This film will explore the unique and painful trauma that psychologists call ambiguous loss. When a loved one passes away, grief is the first and most necessary part of the healing process. But when a loved one disappears without an explanation, the grief becomes complicated by feelings of fear, hope, and delusion. This is ambiguous loss, and it's an emotionally devastating situation. The stories being documented in this film are compelling and heartbreaking and need to be told. If you agree, then please join the journey today by contributing to this campaign.
Think your sister could still be out there after all these years?
If there is any chance that I could find out what happened to her, I need to try.
Legend said there's been a curse on these woods.
Do you believe in the stories about the Blair Witch?
Oh my God.
This looks familiar.
We've been walking in a circle.
No way!
They're everywhere. Who could have done this?
You did this!
Oh my God!
Most people in town have been talking about the Blair Witch most of their lives.